Yeah. Welkom, dit is het Markttheater.
Wij zijn het Markttheater.
Ja, we gaan de voorstelling spelen op straat.
Ja.
Zo, die komt wel binnen, man.
Oh, die had ik even nodig. Hé, hey, wat ruik ik? Volgens mij, ik krijg een boa. Hé, hey, succes met die shit.
Goedemiddag.
Oh, goedemiddag, ja.
U weet wat ik ga zeggen, hè?
Ja, ik snap het. Ze gaan al in de tas.
Nee. Die zorgt voor overlast.
Overlast?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, dan ga ik snel, sorry.
Ik gaat helemaal nergens heen. Regels zijn regels, ik moet u een boete geven.
Een boete? Mm-hmm. Hey, is er aan de hand?
Goeiedag.
Hallo, goeiedag.
Ja, is een melding uit de buurt. Deze meneer zorgt voor overlast.
Oh, nee, dat was ik. Ik ben de buurt. Ik heb een klacht in, maar dat is niet nodig. Het was een misverstand, meneer zorgt niet voor overlast.
En nu is het afgelopen! Pepperspray!
Ha! Pepperspray.
Je omdraaien, lul.
Hij is al weg.
Thank you.
televisie voor blijmoedige mensen en zij die dat willen worden.
Wat ik nou heb neergezet is eigenlijk letterlijk een wonderkamer. Daar gaat het om die verwondering. En dat is een combinatie van technologie en natuur en mensen. Maar ook dat het, hoe groeit dat dan verder? Hoe kan dat dan in zo'n natuurlijke context worden? Dat is een beetje wat ik in aan het zoeken. En eigenlijk wil ik die zoektocht wil ik doen met de mensen die hier naar kijken. En er zijn dus ook QR-codes, die kun je scannen. En dan kun je een formulier invullen en op basis van die formulieren ga ik kijken naar wie vind ik dan leuk om in gesprek te gaan over wat voor werk hier is, de thematiek die eraan hangt en dat mee te nemen. En dan ga ik over 5 weken de eerste container onthullen met een nieuwe invulling. En over 10 weken, na weer een reeks gesprekken, die laatste container. En dan moet dit eigenlijk een totaalverhaal worden. En dat kan best betekenen dat die 3 ook nog weer aangepast moeten worden. Om het kloppen te krijgen. En dat is eigenlijk de zoektocht die ik in wil gaan. Er komt op een gegeven moment weer uitnodiging voor de eerste en voor de tweede. En medio december, dan wil ik eigenlijk nog een keer opengooien en zeggen: dit is het totaalplaatje, dit blijft nog een maand staan.
Dank
u wel.
Succes!
The presentation is going to be on From Symbiocentric Visions to Transformative Change. Exploring artistic approaches as catalysts for envisioning symbiocentric futures and triggering transformative action. Oliver Zaas holds a professorship for design at Macromedia University of Applied Sciences, where he directs the International Master's Program in Design Management. His research focuses on approaches and methods to promote transdisciplinary engagement and critical dialogue among the natural sciences, social sciences, and humanities, with the objective of facilitating regenerative innovation and organizational as well as societal transformation. So give it up for Oliver Zaas.
So hello. So as mentioned already, my name is Oliver Zaas. I'm a professor for design, a little bit higher maybe, or super, thank you, that's easier. I'm professor for design, design management, and design thinking. And this presentation will be about the arts, design, the sciences, and transformation. Before I get started, I realized yesterday, really, that when I talk about design, then everybody has a different opinion what design really is. Yeah? And being a designer myself and being in this whole discipline, or so we all assume all the time that everybody knows exactly what we're talking about. So this is not the case. So when you think about design, you probably think about product design, you probably think about communication design, like graphic design and so forth. Yeah? You probably think about the apps on your smart devices and so forth. Yes, this is all design, but let me give you a very quick overview how design has developed, really, and why it's important for us today to talk about this. So historically speaking, design has actually started in the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, because all of a sudden, the societies moved from craft-oriented society to a mass production society, and all of a sudden these mass-produced items and things around us, they needed some sort of identity through branding and but also styling, yeah, and a new utility and new decorations and stuff like that. This is how design really started. So it started really with product design and branding and communication design. Over the years now, let's say, starting really heavily from the 1950s, 1960s, after the Second World War, all of a sudden we were surrounded with computers, yeah, personal computers, and all of a sudden design needed to deal with that. How do we interact with systems and machines and so forth? The next step was really, as you all know, all of a sudden we were starting to interact, yeah, not only reacting to the machine and prompting inputs, but interacting, and networks became all of a sudden the big thing. Of course, design needed to deal with that. Designers started to work in this field. And so it shows that over the centuries and decades, design has evolved. All these more traditional design disciplines are still here and working successfully. But more and more new design disciplines come up due to the fact that we actually need them, because there are so many tasks that need to be somehow tackled. So designers today, they're doing much more than you might expect. We're working in the field of speculating the future, which is part of the speculative design culture, if you will, or also called critical design. But there's also all kinds of design that deals with bringing something into the world to start discourses. It's called discursive design, for instance. Yeah? So the design is not really the end product, but it's the starting point for discussions and discourses. So let me start with my presentation now after this quick introduction. As we know, this is the right slide, yeah? As we know, Glenn Albrecht coined the term symbiocene as a positive vision to create momentum for transformative change for an age beyond the Anthropocene. And I would like to start this presentation with a quote from him, which I consider very significant. So the symbiocene will be that period in Earth's history where humans symbiotically reintegrate themselves emotionally, psychologically, and technologically into nature and natural systems. This vision, then, is a mental image, or how he calls it, like a mega meme, of what we as human beings need to achieve in the future. It provides the necessary framework within which we can develop strategies as a guide to action. So you could say visions are the foundations to actions. So action, another quote, please allow me to have another quote, action without vision does not know where to go or why to go there. So vision is absolutely necessary to guide and motivate us, and motivate action. So starting from this visionary philosophical foundation, we collectively need to reimagine the future beyond the Anthropocene and develop strategies to help us getting there. So this is why we have founded the nonprofit organization Symbiocene. Yeah, sounds very familiar, I assume, in order to support this vision of a symbiocentric future. We, this is myself and my two co-founding partners, artist, designer, and curator Ingrid Rügemer, and biologist and educator Dr. Tina Heger. They're both not here, they're both in Germany. Together we work at the intersection of sciences and arts, giving space to both cognitive and emotional dimensions of knowledge in order to foster regenerative human-nature relationships, thus open up new perspectives for a livable future for all living beings. Our distinct proposition explores artistic approaches as catalysts for envisioning symbiocentric scenarios and triggering transformative action. And this is a quite interesting story. So when we started this NGO, we obviously were looking for a new name for this organization. And everybody who has tried to start an organization knows how difficult it is to find a really distinct name. And for some reason, it popped up in my mind, Symbiocene. This sounds like a very fitting name for this organization. And then we looked it up right away and found, of course, Glenn online very quickly. And we learned that he not only has coined this term in, I think, around 2011, but he also developed substantial philosophical positions in that regard. So we felt this is super. We have felt very encouraged to support this concept and have made it since our mission to explore opportunities how we can actually integrate our expertises from the arts and the sciences to facilitate a trajectory towards the Symbiocene. So this is the reason why we added the letter S, as you can see, into our logo, because we wanted to empathize the fact that we want to put importance for scenario building and setting the scene to make the concept more tangible. So this is the distinction from the original term. So let's look into the scene for this presentation. Let's start with the term symbio. We are all very much aware of symbiosis in a biological sense. You know, it's a reciprocal relationship between two organisms that give and take. To put it very simply, symbiosis is generally a close, long-term, and mutually beneficial biological interaction. So let's investigate the relationship of humans and nature over the last centuries. We analyzed the development of the human-nature relationship in the Anthropocene, and our framework explains the trajectory from an anthropocentric degenerative thinking and acting paradigm to a symbiocentric regenerative thinking paradigm. None of those paradigms has replaced the other yet. The different thinking paradigms actually do exist simultaneously. I start with a predominant economic-centric paradigm, which has received significant momentum in the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. This capitalist economic logic has been mainly driven by economic growth and technological advancements, and is deeply embedded in all aspects of our thinking. The driving philosophy and system behind this paradigm is the view of the world with its living and non-living entities as capital. So the human capital and the natural capital and so forth. From this perspective, humans are separated from nature and everything in the world becomes an asset for the economy. So the human-centric thinking paradigm begins to see humans with all their needs. This is the next level here. This also shows in the emergence of the independent study fields like psychology, sociology, ergonomics, human factor engineering, and from design, for instance, user-centered design and human UX design, which is user experience design, if you have heard this term before. So the next level would be the sustainability-centric thinking paradigm, which is driven by the measurable impact of human behavior on nature. Humans have begun to understand the planetary ecological boundaries, recognizing the urgency and magnitude of this challenge due to health issues, rapidly declining biodiversity, climate change and land degradation, and so on and so forth. The term sustainability is being used to describe the need to reduce harmful human behavior in order to stabilize and maintain the current economic system. And one could argue, and we all do, I guess, that the current conceptualization of sustainability is focused on mitigating harms and doing less bad is actually not enough. On this trajectory, we have included an additional step, the planet-centric thinking, a paradigm that recently started to emerge, focusing on coupling human and natural systems. An approach which strives to find solutions that not only sustains, but regenerates. So regeneration means to revive, to grow again, instead of simply putting or buying time by slowing the pace of destruction and regenerative approach aims to restore and enhance the integrity of local and regional ecosystems with the human actors as creative partners in this process. So with this trajectory, we wanted to show how paradigms of thought evolve over time. Thinking beyond these paradigms, especially deeply entrenched human dominance, is extremely difficult, as we all know, and therefore radically new perspectives are hard to imagine. So before we can start reimagining the human nature relationship within the symbiocene, we need to ask ourselves, okay, who are we? What is actually human? And here's some interesting detail. Yeah? A healthy body is home to around 1 quadrillion microorganisms. This is a number with, I have to check, 12 zeros. So it's very impossible to imagine that. Yeah? What is it really? The next one is a little bit clearer. That is about 10 times as many microorganisms in a human body than human cells. Gets clearer. And for an adult, this is about 2 kilograms of non-human organisms. So every one of you has something like 1 or 2 kilos of non-human organisms in you. Yeah? I think this makes it quite clear. So, and then we have discussed it wonderfully already with the previous presentation, what is really nature? Yeah? Many idealize nature as pristine and untouched. Yeah? A challenge to the idea of nature as the pristine is in fact that human-induced transformation can be found even in the remotest and seemingly untouched ecosystems. This reinforces the argument that pristine nature and wilderness are cultural and even romantic constructions that urgently need to be called into question. And as you might know, some environmental ethicists go further, and we discussed it yesterday already a little bit and also today, that we should actually stop using the term nature because it carries with it the notion of something outside and independent of humans. With this in mind, let's try to explore how we can envision a symbiocentric future or futures. In order to find answers for this question, we have to investigate how we make sense of the world. How do we actually construct our worldview? This process starts from the moment we are born. Every thought and every action is triggered by a sensory exploration and a sense-making process. So our surrounding environment has impact on our thoughts and actions. And let's have a quick look at the process itself. We created this graphic here to make it a little bit clearer. So the sensory sense-making framework, as we call it, helps to understand the process by which people try to understand events in their environment. It is based on the theory of embodied cognition, which assumes that cognitive processing and the way knowledge is acquired is influenced by direct bodily experiences and considers the physical body as an agent for knowledge generation and knowledge transfer. So to sum up this framework, sense-making is significantly supported by sensory perception and sensory-motor interaction, so how we move in our environment, in the physical and the social environment. So the process of sense-making is closely linked to imagination, creativity, and problem-solving. These traits, and this is the wonderful thing here, are deeply human characteristics. One very important aspect in this regard is to consider the factor of motivation. It is the preliminary stage, you could also say the spark, that triggers creative action. So motivation to improve any situation has always been a big driver for change throughout the development of the whole humankind. So it all started with the development of the first tools, and maybe even earlier or so, but this is a very good example, in the Stone Age. If you look at these examples, maybe some of them started with some accidents or so, but it basically, you have to acknowledge that these are not accidental shapes, but they are actually thought, yeah? They are being developed with thought. And today, design, and the Stone Age basically would be the real beginning of design, if you will. Design is everywhere. The whole artificial world is being designed. Yeah? Everything that you surround yourself with has been designed. And this has a massive impact on planet Earth, of course, as we know, and its natural systems, but much more than that. It also has a massive effect on us humans and the way we live and we work, what we eat, our relationship to the natural world, and on life itself. We even started to design ourselves. So until here, we have come a long way, and we are not simply inventing tools. The tools and artifacts we design have also impact on us, our thinking and acting. So you could say humans and their environments have a reciprocal impact on each other, and everything we bring into this world has impact. So you could sum it up with design designs. And consequently, this also means that we have a great potential to transform ourselves and our behavior. Our thinking and acting can actually change. Now I'm coming back to motivation that I mentioned earlier. I use this rather trivial example to demonstrate how much effort and people and also money people put into something when they are really motivated to change something. In this case, to transform herself into a real life Barbie, yeah, which is a real thing. So let's take a quick look at the process of transformation. To respond to the challenges of the Anthropocene, scholars from various disciplines increasingly emphasize that both the inner and outer transformation needs to be addressed. In this framework, we investigate how the inner and outer dimensions relate to each other and how inner transformation leads to outer transformation and vice versa. To explain briefly this framework, I would like to start with the fact that thinking and acting is a constant cycle of action and reflection. Transformation can start, though, on all levels, for instance, on a personal, the social, or the planetary dimension. However, a culture transformation has to come from inner mindsets and values. So it's crucial to acknowledge that transformation is determined by our dominant paradigm. Paradigms define how we understand and shape the world, and one of our biggest challenges is to overcome predominant thinking. A number of scholars argue that the currently prevailing paradigm, which is characterized by reductionism, dualism, and mechanistic thinking, could be one reason why the challenges of sustainability are not being adequately addressed. As an alternative, we propose the concept of a relational paradigm with holistic rather than dualistic thinking, which is about understanding the mutual relationship between the social and ecological systems. A relational paradigm might offer the potential for inner and outer transformation in the Anthropocene, but it needs imagining, yeah, which relates to the issues of values and creativity. And this leads me to environmental humanities, which draw humanities disciplines, including the arts and design, into conversations with the natural and the social sciences around significant environmental issues. The arts, with their critical, reflective, and embodying qualities, can help to imagine, shape, and communicate this relational paradigm with its new values. It has the power to create new experiences and to trigger new perspectives. So at this point, I would like to show an example. This is the work from the artist duo Rita Ikonen and Caroline Yorth, and they have a project called Eyes as Big as Plates. They have started their project more than 10 years ago. They investigate the human-nature relationship and develop symbiotic narratives. They are finding people all over the world who are willing to participate in their artistic interventions and to deep dive into this experience. Ingrid, one of our co-founding partners and the curator of Symbioscene, she curated this exhibition in Munich, and we also facilitated a photo production with them, because it's obviously all photos, and they, we supported them in producing two new portraits in the time when they were in Munich. And this shows the next slide. It's actually the process of going into the forest near Munich and working with two collaborators, in this this time Tina and Michael, and they gradually became integrated in the natural environment. Also, what we do is, after the photo shoot, we hosted a related talk series with scientists and philosophers who presented their research on views on the human relations, human nature relations, and reflected on the relational paradigm. So, to sum up, before change happens, new seeing needs to happen. And after that, new understanding needs to happen, and subsequently new thinking needs to happen. And this has ultimately influence on our behavior and actions, as we have visualized in this framework here as well. So, but as we all know, our challenges are super complex. In design, we call them even wicked problems we're dealing with. So imagination alone seems not to be enough. We need strategies to turn these imaginations into reality and methods that enable people to participate in identifying and solving problems, which leads us to design. And I'm showing here the design thinking process. Some of you might be quite familiar with that. Design has developed successful iterative approaches to deal with complexity. It uses a variety of theoretical principles and methods and practical methods, ranging from multidisciplinary design research, theoretical formulation, fostering creativity and ideation, implementing knowledge through prototyping, and last but not least, testing these prototypes and learn from that. And this is also very much a normal design process, if you will. And now I want to show some practical examples. We had a lot of theories and a lot of sort of conceptual aspects discussed now. This is an example of some work I did with my MA students in design management. It's for the Senckenberg Institution for Biodiversity and Earth System Research in Germany. The interesting thing here was a project for the Chiquitano dry forest in Bolivia, where we engaged local communities, local NGOs, and scientists in co-creation processes to proactively engage local communities in the conservation of the dry forest environment. And important is to notice that these strategies were developed with everybody together, so it's a co-creation process. This is another example of a project, not really a project, but an exhibition we had in Germany. This is the designer, Sarah Martinson. She's working in natural fibers. And here it becomes clear how important it is not only to work in this field, but to communicate this. And she has created a material encyclopedia with all the information available. So if you want to check this out, this is super interesting. Next example is arts and science collaboration. We had it yesterday already a little bit to talk about biodesign. This is another example how successful designers work with scientists, even if it's quite complicated. Yes, it is. And if you were here yesterday, the speaker also mentioned that. But it's worthwhile to take a view from a design perspective towards sciences and work out methods and methodologies how we work together. And another example I wanted to show, this is Sena Holloway. We also had an exhibition with her in Munich. Her work is about growing design. Yeah, her project is called Rootful. She has received a lot of product awards and stuff like that. And it's about creating new regenerative aesthetics here. And so, of course, fashion and other design fields are super important to bring these results out into the world. One more thing I wanted to mention. I'm currently working on a new framework, which is called Symbiocentric Transition Through Arts and Design Framework. It's a university project, yes. It's a research project, and it's about bringing different perspectives into the conversation. So starting with the dimension symbiocentric visions for transitions, then the framework points here out that the capabilities of the arts to inform a collective shift in culture and consciousness through new experiences and new perspectives. And the arts are also particularly suited to inform the dimension symbiocentric posture and mindset. This is here on the right-hand side. By supporting the exploration of diverse worldviews and the critical reflection of values. And then design comes in with its creative approaches and synthesizing methods that help to transform visions into strategies and actions. And last but not least, design can foster transdisciplinary collaboration and knowledge transfer to develop new theories that integrate a broad range of academic and non-academic disciplines. So this research project, and I come to the end now, is still work in progress. And I would like everybody who feels that they can contribute to this project to come to me and let me know and contact me. We are very interested to get a multitude of disciplines and research paradigms and viewpoints into this model. So please feel free to contact me anytime. Here are my contact details, or also I'm very happy to pass on my business cards if anybody's interested. Thank you very much for listening, and I'm happy to answer some questions.
Televisie voor blijmoedige mensen en zij die dat willen worden.